Warning: The Savage Nation contains adult language, adult content, psychological nudity. Listener discretion is advised. And now, America's most exciting radio talk show, The Savage Nation, home of unprotected talk, borders, language, culture. And here he is, Michael Savage.
May 8th, 2015. It's a very big day in the world. You know why, don't you? It's the day that people are celebrating victory over Europe Day, meaning the defeat of the Nazis, forgotten by most conservatives who focused only on Ronald Reagan, not understanding that without World War II, we wouldn't be here. Now, we're going to talk a little bit about World War II, VE Day, what it means to us today. We're going to talk about the elections in England, which mean more to me than anyone else in radio, because I'm still the only radio host or member of the American media banned from entering England. And the last time Cameron won, I was told from people in the background that he would take me off the list. Well, he never took me off the list, nor do I think he'll do it now. But it's not about me. In the third part of the show today is this. I'm dedicating today's show to my silent brother, Jerome, who was born May 8th, 1944, and was silent his entire life and died in a home at a very young age. And today's show is dedicated to my silent brother, Jerome, and all real special needs children. All real special needs children and my brother Jerome today are being honored. And I'll tell that story for those of you who never heard it. It's important to know why I am who I am, because, frankly, he speaks through me. And we'll talk about that as well. But I want to begin with England and the defeat of the Labour Party, Ed Miliband. Thank God he lost. But, you know, don't count your blessings so fast. It's all a sham. There's very little difference between the Labour Party in England and the Tory Party in England, and I'll prove it in one sentence. Take a guess who advised Cameron on how he could win the election. Obama's campaign manager, Jim Messina. What does that tell you? If Obama's political advisor, Jim Messina, is getting credit for leading conservative British Prime Minister David Cameron to a victory, what does it tell you about David Cameron? It tells you it's all rigged. It tells you there's no difference in the West between one side and the other with regard to most issues. Certainly there are fine details that separate the two. But if Axelrod is representing the Labour Party in advising them, and he loses, and Jim Messina, who he calls his brother, advised the other guy, it tells you the same scam that's going on in America is going on in England. Moreover, what the hell are these guys doing in England to begin with? What do they need these creeps to go over there for and mess up the English elections? There's only one good note coming out of England. I want you to hear it in clip two. This is the Labour Party, the Ed Miliband, who was defeated. Listen what he said in clip two.
This has clearly been a very disappointing and difficult night for the Labour Party.
Thank God.
We haven't made the gains we wanted in England and Wales. And in Scotland, we've seen a surge of nationalism overwhelm our party.
Did you hear the word nationalism? Who in America who has been calling for a nationalist party, Michael Savage, who has told you that a nationalist party could win after a certain number of years in America, Michael Savage? Who has defined his radio career by the three words, borders, language, and culture, Michael Savage? But here's the good news. In England, when a party leader is defeated, he resigns out of shame. I want you to listen to three, and you'll hear what a real democracy sounds like in clip three.
Britain needs a strong Labour Party. Britain needs a Labour Party that can rebuild after this defeat so we can have a government that stands up for working people again. And now it's time for someone else to take forward the leadership of this party. So I'm tendering my resignation, taking effect after this afternoon's commemoration of VE Day at the Cenotaph. I want to do so straight away, because the party needs to have an open and honest debate about the right way forward without constraint.
So he resigned. He resigned because he lost. Now, in America, we had an election in November. It was a landslide against Obama's communist, socialist, Islamist policies. And instead of resigning, as he should have, You know what he did? He told us to drop dead. He doubled down, then he tripled down on his left-wing fanaticism. So don't fool yourself for 1 minute. The left wing in this country is a broken wing. America has rejected that broken wing. America has said no to that broken wing over and over again. But this small band of fanatics who have destroyed the Democrat Party, the same small band of fanatics who dominate the American media, want you to believe that they are the majority. They are not the majority. They're a tiny minority. And that's the opening to the show. The phone number here is 855-407-2822. Robert, look at the telos, please, because something's wrong with it again. I think I'm in a new studio, by the way. Michael Savage is in a studio that I was in from 1994 to approximately 2008. I did many, many shows in this studio, many. It's like a bunker built into the side of a hill. I mean, this is the real McCoy. This is dug into the side of a hill. And I've been doing shows from other studios, but I'm back in this one. I had all new equipment put in. Feels good to be. It's like going back to an old home that you know about. But owing to the madness in America today and the threats that those of us who are telling the truth are facing, I have five studios, and I move around from one to the other, and no one knows where I am from day to day for obvious reasons. That's not invented. It's not a shtick. It's real. That's what I have to do to survive the vermin on the left. And I think the best way to continue on the show right now is get right down to it. Again, May 8th is a special day for me because on May 8th, 1944, my brother, the silent brother Jerome, was born. And he died October 12th, 1969, never having spoken a word and never having done more than breathe. He had to be cared for all his life. I have to be rather careful in what I say to you about this topic because it's very emotional for me, and I really don't want to get schmaltzy, and I don't want you to think I'm using my brother for any reason other than to say the show is dedicated to my silent brother and all real, emphasis real, special needs children. So let me read you three pages from a book I wrote years ago called Psychological Nudity, entitled My Silent Brother. Here it is. I remember that the day they gave Jerome away, my uncle was crying like a baby in front of the South Bronx tenement we lived in. All the neighbors were out watching. Think Calcutta, a Sajat Ray film. The little blonde boy with blue eyes was only five. I was seven. My sister was nine. He was packed off like an animal to live and suffer and die in silence, alone in one of New York's snake pits after another. The so-called doctor told my parents he would only live to age seven. He lied. The great doctor also told my parents, quote, it would be better for the other children to give him away. This created a lifetime of shame and guilt for me. I became emotionally responsible for discarding this helpless little boy whom I love more than anyone else in my entire life. How I love my little defenseless brother. I can't do it. I can't read the story. I'm sorry. I just can't read it. I just don't want to go down this road. I just can't do it. It weakens me to tell you the story. And what can I say to you? That's the story. I can't go on with this. It's too much. It's just too much. I'll read you the end. Finally, after about 20 years in one hellhole after another, he died after being attacked and bitten on most of his body by a maniac, housed there with helpless, innocent souls unable to defend themselves. Jerome is buried in the same cemetery as my mother and father in hard clay soil in an old Long Island potato field. He was the Jesus of our family who died for my sins. Three pages, my silent brother, that's the story. What can you say about it? Nothing. I'm sorry I read it to you, actually. But I'd rather do that than talk about, you know, the United Kingdom elections. I mean, no one in the media has more at stake in what happened in the UK in the media than me. Because remember, I'm the only member of the media, I'm proud to tell you, still banned from entering England. And I told you the story. The definitive fight for free speech is me. And how one man stood firm against an entire government to free my name from a list of murderers and terrorists. And I've never freed my name because of Gordon Brown and the scum in the Labour Party. So thank God at least the Labour Party didn't win. But Cameron, who had promised people who knew me he'd take my name off the list, shamed himself by not doing so. You know what I'm saying? It's a huge scandal in England. And what's going on in America is very, very near and dear to my heart because of what went on in England. And I know an awful lot about free speech. And I want to make a side note No one in the American media save one person came to my defense. I think it was only Laura Ingraham on radio who came to my aid. Not the big mouth Rush Limbaugh, the great conservative. He made believe it didn't happen. Because if it's not about him and if he can't capitalize on it in some way or make it part of his show, it's of no interest to him. He didn't help me. Certainly Hannity didn't say a word. O'Reilly didn't say a word. No one on Fox News came to my aid. But the preface of the book says the savage fight against censorship. Isn't that interesting? Isn't that funny? Savage was fighting against censorship in England. And it's an important story. We can talk about that as well. Banned in Britain, Michael Savage beating the liberal blacklist. Well, I never beat it. I'm still on it. We can talk about Barack Obama's political advisor, Jim Messina, getting credit for leading conservative British Prime Minister David Cameron to an overwhelming victory. You get that one? And then we're going to talk about how the Nazis were crushed in World War II, how every man defeated Superman, how they were overrun and defeated by every man here in the United States of America. I think that's a pretty good show, and I invite you to call 855-400-728. While they're calling, we're going to go to a quick commercial break so you can listen to the great people who put their money where their mouth is and back the show. I'll be right back.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-400-7282. Savage.
My Savage Nation is sponsored by SwissAmerica.com, the only company I trust to protect my wealth with gold and silver. Call 800-BUYCOIN.
After the hour of Savage Nation, I think I've regained my composure. I'm going to continue the two pages. The story my silent brother has found in my book, Train Tracks, and I'm just going to continue because you'll see why I have dedicated my life to defending the defenseless and how the vermin on the left have turned me into what I am not in order to make certain that no one really listens to me, but they've been defeated. My success is their greatest defeat. So let me pick it up. So they gave the child away, and it made me emotionally scarred. Because they told me they were doing it for the healthy children. And I said, how I love my little defenseless brother, born blind and deaf and unable to hold himself up. All those times I would secretly sneak into the kitchen where he sat propped up in a high chair. Don't go in there. Don't bother him. He can't see you or hear you anyway. But I would slip in and whistle to him, and his eyes would light up. I would see a sparkle where the doctor said there was only darkness. So I knew he could hear me whistling to him and see my shadow or smell me. He was alive. And they were told to exile him by the doctor for my sake. Well, after he was gone, the little apartment became more silent than when the silent boy was there. For years afterward, I would sneak into the dresser drawer where my mother preserved his little clothing and eyeglasses. They tried to see if they would work. I would hold one of his laundered shirts to my nose, pressing the fabric right into my nostrils to glean a few molecules of his scent. I even wore his eyeglasses, making the room all blurry. My brother, they took him away. Well, for decades, not just the 2 years she was told he would live, my poor mother took buses and subways all the way out to Staten Island to a hellhole or up to Poughkeepsie to visit him. Sometimes my sister went with her, but mostly she went alone. The new clothing she brought for him on each and every visit was never seen on him. They wheeled him out in the same institutional sackcloth. The clothing was stolen. She would come home wrecked and hopeless for days afterward. The arguments between my parents started to get very bad after this, with both blaming each other when it was really the doctor's fault. There was some kind of medication given during pregnancy that damaged my brother's central nervous system during development. Well, finally, after about 20 years in one hellhole after another, he died, after being attacked and bitten on most of his body by a maniac, housed there with helpless, innocent souls, unable to defend themselves. I read the rest before, so I'm doing this because I want you to understand that there are so many people in the world with children with real special needs who suffer themselves in their own silence. And while the government wisely helps these people as best they can, there are people who capitalize on special needs benefits by declaring their children to have special needs when they don't really have them. Along the lines of the frauds you see with the blue tickets on their cars, who are not handicapped, who park in handicap zones, who you want to strangle. Do you feel like strangling those people? I get so infuriated because they're ripping off something that was created for the really handicapped, you know, the parking zones. And every time I see a person parking one, I stare at them when they get out with, and then all of a sudden they look at you, they reach for a fake cane, and then they hobble over into the, you know, they make believe that they're, I know the game, they get some quack doctor to write that they have arthritis, and they get a blue card. It's sickening. And the same thing is going on with the children with special needs. The scant resources that are available are being ripped off by people who claim their child has this and has that, and then they get them, you know, tutors, all to cash in on the system. 855-407-282. What do you want to talk about? WABC Judy, welcome to the Savage Nation. What's on your mind?
Hi, Michael. I want you to know, I'm going to stop crying now. When I heard you talk about your brother, and describe him like such an angel, and that at the age of 5 they shipped him off, and how you suffered, and how your mother must have suffered, I'm just so emotional. And then you don't want to talk about it, but I wanted to hear more. And then you started reading on more, but I'm holding on. I couldn't hear it. But my point is, I do relate on some level because my daughter, 17 years ago, gave birth to a special needs, legally blind, speech-impaired, motor skill challenged child. And I have been in his life for all this time. And when I think about these horror stories from Willowbrook and what you tell me about your brother and how he died, it's just so upsetting to me. And I know you're probably walking around with such crazy guilt, and you should not feel guilty about anything. You were a kid yourself. And you just be a champion for all these special kids. That's what you should do, Michael. I'm just so upset. I don't know, you really upset me a lot.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-400-7282.
Again, we're celebrating VE Day, Victory Over Hitler Day. It's called VE, Victory Over Europe Day. Of course, the Japanese were defeated on a different day back in the ancient times when America still had a historical memory. We're talking about the UK election and how it's somewhat of a distortion to believe the Conservatives won because the campaign advisor for the conservative leader is Barack Obama's campaign advisor, Jim Messina. So what does that tell you? It tells you it's all the whole thing is a shuck and jive. And then being May 8th, it's my deceased brother's birthday, my silent brother. And so they're dedicating the whole show to all real special need children. That's what it comes down to. And if you care to join the conversation, the phone number, well, we have one open line at 855-407-282. I've got some great calls here, and I'm not trying to limit it to any one of these topics. We have other things to talk about as well, but I don't know. May 8th is a big day for me, and frankly, I'm sort of an emotional state of flux right now. I don't know which way my emotions are going to take me, and I'm really still... I couldn't even answer that last caller when she called and she was broken up. I wanted to say something to her, but I wasn't in the proper voice to reply to her, to be honest with you, because I heard how wrecked she was from the member, you know, her own situation. And she was feeling for me, I think, more than anything else. And I got more compassion from her than I did from anyone in my life, frankly, in my own life. I come from a very tough family, and I come from a very old world family. They don't look at the world the way most of you do. And I got to tell you, you know, you come from immigrant people. They don't see the world the same way that most Americans do. And I think it's true today. They have a very harsh view of reality. And, you know, with particularly the Russians. Did we lose the feed here, Robert? I keep hearing beeping. I mean, I'm sorry. I'm just in the studio. I'm spooked. So anyway, the point is that, you know, there was a pretty harsh opinion on this at the time, which I'd rather not even mention, to be frank with you. So let's take some calls on the Savage Nation. WLWI Radio. Celia, welcome to the Savage Nation. Go ahead, please.
Thank you, Michael. I, too, have a silent daughter. I had rubella, which got her sight, her hearing, her speech. She had heart damage, but she's still alive. She is with a care family who can handle her way much better than I could. There is a light in her eyes, but I could never find enough help at the time of her birth. She'll be 58 in December.
Wow.
Yes.
She lived that long.
Yes, they don't know why. But there is a purpose. God has given her to us for a reason.
That's right.
And
I believe whether it's God or fate, there is a reason that can be, let's say, gleaned from such situations and used to the betterment of the family. I, for one, I'll tell you from my point of view, Celia, I've thought about it, you know, my whole life. And when I became an adult, I started to realize, the more I thought about it, that I am living for him as well as for myself. And on the days I don't feel like doing the show or I don't feel like working very hard, I do it for him. I feel as though there's two men inside of me, you know, he and I. I feel that his heart beats inside of mine. I mean, you know, I'm living for him.
When you were with him, you've got to keep that in your heart, because if he knew you were there and you knew it, then you made him so happy that words cannot even describe.
Well, I tell you this, learning how to communicate with him taught me how to communicate with animals and how to communicate with audiences, because audiences who you don't know or see really are not very dissimilar, incidentally. And it's a gift to be able to actually, you can communicate with, people can talk to an audience and not communicate with them. Very few people can emote with an audience. Very few people can make an audience feel their feelings. Entertainers who are good can do that. And I can do it. It's not common in talk radio. A lot of it's good, but it's two-dimensional or one-dimensional. But it doesn't really touch the people emotionally. It may touch them intellectually or mentally, you know. But I know that many people who listen to the show feel like I'm talking directly to them and they're talking directly to me. I am a part of their life. Isn't that correct with you, Celia?
Thank you so much.
Thank you, my friend. She's not really my friend, but thank you. I just, you know, it's just a matter of habit. So look, I don't want to bum you guys out today with this story. Many of you probably don't want to talk about it. I get it. It's kind of sad. But so what? Pathos is part of life. That's what's missing in so much of our discussion. If you listen to even the why do you think conservatives are so misunderstood? Because they're so bombastic in their descriptions of what they would like to see in the nation and the world. And I'm responsible for the same mentality some of the time. People lose the fact that they actually have a compassionate desire to save the country for the betterment of most mankind. But that's what we're talking about here, is compassion at the end of the day. So let's go on to some of the callers here. KKQA, is that? Oh, Deborah, KKOH in Reno, Nevada. Welcome to the Savage Nation. What's on your mind, Deborah?
I have a son that was born in 1970. He went through a labor and delivery he shouldn't have. The doctors knew better. I had tremendous labor for days and days. They finally took him emergency surgery, and he suffered a massive brain injury. I was told the night before leaving the hospital by a nurse, thank God for her, you know what, they're going to tell you tomorrow not to bring him home. He's a vegetable. It'll ruin your life. I could lose my job over this.
Mm.
He says, your baby is very, very sick. He is brain injured. He's convulsing constantly. But if you put him in an institution, he stands no chance at all. If you take him home, you can always place him at any time. Well, I took him home. He walked at 18 months. He started to talk at about 5. Now, he is severely developmentally disabled. He walks, he talks. I had him housebroken at 18 months. And I just recently, in August, had to place him in a group home because the years of medication for his seizures and behaviors have...
I think what you're saying is had you had him terminated in the hospital, you wouldn't have had any good years with him, right?
He would be dead.
But Deborah, let me ask you something. In your heart of hearts, do you feel he enjoys any part of his day?
Yes, I do. I do. He communicates. He tells you what he likes and what he...
Well, that's the part that kills me, I mean, when I think about it. Because if my brother had been born today in these times, which are so more advanced than what the doctors knew in those times, I see kids like him in wheelchairs in Berkeley, California, who are completely incapacitated physically, who are moving a wheelchair, let us say, almost with their brain waves.
But you saw that in him.
I knew that. I knew more than the stupid doctor, may he rest in hell, knew. I knew more than a doctor. I was 5 years old, and I knew more than the idiot doctor.
because they turn their back and they convince parents to turn their back that your life will be over if you do this. Yeah, you do.
Well, I know when I whistle to my dog now, my little dog, Teddy, I feel like I'm communicating in the same way. You know, I look at the dog and he's sleeping next to me during a show and or in the morning. And sometimes I want to talk to him. I see I start to praise him. You know, dogs, their eyes light up. They love praise, don't they? Don't they just love animals, just love you to recognize them.
I have three of them.
And so this brings us, and I want to move on, Deborah. Thank you. I want to make it a more generic discussion. It's one of the reasons I'm an animal rights activist, which I am, and one of the reasons that I dedicate funds and whatever I can do to save elephants. And I think we've done gorillas and dogs and stuff. We never talk about it. We don't wear it on our sleeve. But the fact is, there's a reason for it. They're defenseless. These animals are defenseless in this mechanized world filled with a vicious beast called man, hunting them to extinction. And so we have to be our brother's keeper in that regard. We have to protect our little animal friends. I was reading about koala bears last night. You know, those cute little furry bears from Australia. I just saw one. I looked into it because I love my dog so much. I said, gee, I wonder if I can get a koala bear. Well, I found out no one is allowed to keep a koala bear as a pet because there were about millions of them in Australia before the European invaded the continent. And then now they're down to about 80,000. They're a protected species. And their habitat is being denuded on a regular basis. They eat eucalyptus leaves, would you believe it? No other animal has evolved to the point where they can eat a eucalyptus leaf. If you want to think about the miracle of evolution, the koala eats eucalyptus leaves, and he extracts from the eucalyptus leaf nutrients on which he lives, including moisture, which is his water supply in an arid region. It's miraculous, this little animal. They sleep 20 to 22 hours a day. I can go for that. But they sleep a lot because the energy their bodies require to digest the harsh eucalyptus leaf is very high, the high requirements for calories to digest the leaf. They chew and chew and chew and chew and chew and chew and chew. And so it's a very, very calorie-intensive process, and they preserve their energy by sleeping. It's a phenomenal adaptation in the koala bear. But nevertheless, my little dog Teddy reminds me of a koala bear, so that's why I thought about it. But they are protected in Australia, and people know that. They treat them very, very well because there are sensitive people on the earth, except in China. I would say in China is the most vicious nation on the earth with regard to animals. They are absolutely rapacious. And if there was really a UN, they would arrest the people who were selling and trading in ivory. But I would suspect, by what I know about the world, that there are UN people listening to this show who are in the ivory trade behind the scenes. That's how much faith I have in the United Nations. So we're liable to see the elephant go extinct in our lifetime. Maybe Rush Limbaugh can laugh about it and say, ho, 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 ho. Well, ha, ha, I eat elephant meat. You think I have no contempt for these people who hate animals or make a joke of those of us who protect animals, saying it's not a conservative thing to be kind to animals? I spit on them. That's how I feel about it. Leviticus. Now, what does the Bible say about handicapped people and how to treat them? You're going to be shocked when I read Leviticus to you because it may not be what you thought. You want to talk about harshness? You're about to hear it when I return right here on the Savage Nation.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-400-7282. Savage.
Your Savage Nation is sponsored by SwissAmerica.com. It's the only company I trust for tangible assets, gold and silver. Call 800-BUY-COIN.
So, we're talking about severely handicapped children. And this show is dedicated to my silent brother, Jerome, who was born on May 8th, 1944, and died when he was a young kid, really. He wasn't really that young, but he died in a home. Call it a home, some home, like a snake pit. That's how they were treated. So the show is dedicated to all real special needs children. And I think that the mark of a society is how you care for the weakest members of the society. That's certainly been said before. And on that list, we're probably right at the top of the list in the United States of America. Now let's look around the world. Ask yourselves how ISIS treats the handicapped. I would imagine that anyone who sets other human beings alive on fire while they're alive wouldn't have much of a respect for the handicapped. the compassionate practitioners of the religion of peace. I'd like to know what the Quran has to say about how to deal with the handicapped. And the reason I ask that is because much of the Quranic literature is based strictly upon the Old Testament from which it was derived and from the New Testament from which it was derived. Never forget, Islam was the last of the three of the monotheistic religions. I mean, by Obama and the others, you'd think it was before Abraham, but it wasn't. Judaism was here a long time before Christianity, and both were here a long time before Muhammad appeared on the planet, which is not to deride Islam, but I'm just telling you that a lot of it derives from Judaism and Christianity. Here's the problem. While Jews have gone through a reformation, and Christians have certainly gone through a reformation in their interpretation and practice of the original teachings, we cannot say the same for many in the Muslim community. Certainly there are modern Muslims who are identical to you and I with regard to humanity and humanism. We know that. But unfortunately for us, there are many who aren't. And why we would bring in retrogrades like this, there's only one reason for it. Why would you bring in retrogrades who have a literal interpretation of a holy book which says stone homosexuals to death or kill adulterers and such and make it even broader and kill the infidel? So if you read Leviticus 21, the original document, the old Jewish Bible, it's not very compassionate at all with regard to defects. That's what they call it. The Lord said to Moses, say to Aaron, for the generations to come, none of your descendants who has a defect may come near to offer the food of his God. No man who has any defect may come near. No man who is blind or lame, disfigured or deformed. No man with a crippled foot or hand, or who is hunchbacked or dwarfed, who has any eye defect, who has festering or running sores or damaged testicles. No descendant of Aaron the priest who has any defect is to come near to present the offerings made to the Lord by fire. He has a defect. He must not come near to offer the food of his God. He may eat the most holy food of his God as well as the holy food. Did you see that one? Yet because of his defect, he must not go near the curtain or approach the altar and so desecrate my sanctuary. I am the Lord who makes them holy. That's the original document from Leviticus. I don't know whether Orthodox Jews believe that or practice it. I kind of doubt it. But the fact is, the Old Testament is a very harsh document. They were like the Vikings at the time. That was the Jewish Vikings were the ones who lived in the Old Testament. Think about what I just said to you. That's never been said before. They were a warrior people. They weren't Woody Allen telling a self-deprecating joke. They were warrior people, the tribes, the ancient tribes of Israel. And if anyone was weak, they didn't have much time for them. They didn't kill them, certainly, but they didn't elevate them to God's head. So I'm just telling you what the Old Testament says. Many of you didn't even know that, which brings to mind some other thoughts, because I get into these trains of thoughts. I don't know where it's going to end. We can talk about the World War II celebration today. WVNN Radio. Randy, we have such little time. Please make your point as quickly as you can.
Okay, maybe your silent brother represents the white owl.
You mean the white owl that I saw wisely watching everything?
Yes.
Could be my brother watching from heaven?
Yes, I mean, just intertwined in your memory. He's still alive in your memory.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable. If I were a Native American, I would go out into the forest at the end of this show, and I would do a dance in the woods, calling the white owl. But I'm just a boy from the Bronx who doesn't know any Indian chants. All I can do is dream.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-400-7282. Warning, the Savage Nation contains adult language, adult content, psychological nudity. Listener discretion is advised. And now, America's most exciting radio talk show, The Savage Nation, home of unprotected talk, borders, language, culture. And here he is, Michael Savage.
Iskadal viskadal shemei rabo, beolimodi verochi reusei, viamlich malchusei, bechayei choinu, vioi meichoinu, vechayei dechol beis Yisroel,
The heights of the human mind and the human soul. Today's show is dedicated to all of the special needs children in the world and to all of those graves which hold our soldiers who liberated us from the Nazis. They are not forgotten today on the Savage Nation. And that's why I'm doing this show today. Yes, it has a special meaning to me, May 8th. It's a confluence of dates. It's the birth date of my deceased brother, Jerome, which I talked about in the first hour, which I'd rather not repeat. But it's also a day that is widely considered to be the day that is Hitler was the victory in Europe day. It's the day that victory was declared. We have Winston Churchill on that, don't we? That's a beautiful one, Robert. You dug that one up. Let's listen to one of the great men of history who Obama hates. In fact, your socialist, communist, anti-American president removed the bust of Winston Churchill from the White House. This is to show you what kind of individual we have sitting in that chair, how he has polluted the White House. And a president named Truman, true man, made the decision that he'd rather kill them than see more boys, more American boys die, and he bombed them. Can you imagine how we have fallen from those days when real men who loved America ran the country to the kind of creatures that now inhabit the highest offices? Can you imagine how far we have fallen? But don't give up heart, and don't give up hope. Because look at England. The liars, the louts, the vermin in the media kept telling you that it was neck to neck, tie to tie. Labor was maybe going to win, and you know, this one was going to lose. There was an overwhelming landslide in favor of the Tories, the Conservative Party. In fact, in Scotland, the Nationalist Party won. In fact, in Scotland, the youngest member of their parliament has been elected. He's 20 years old. He's a diehard nationalist. I have no doubt in my mind that here in the United States of America, there is a very strong nationalist streak that wants the borders closed, the language English reaffirmed, and the culture of the United States of America supported from the highest offices. I have no doubt in my mind that if we had one such Republican, which we do not have, that individual could sweep the Labor Party in America into the gutter from whence they came. The Labor Party in America, of course, being the Democrat Socialist Islamist Party of Hillary Clinton and Al Gore. Liars and anti-Americans all. So here we are. We have no nationalist presence, and we're sitting here watching the world go by. That's one topic. That's two topics. VE Day, UK election, brother's birthday, Mother's Day coming up on Sunday. What a day that's going to be. It's a great, you know, people say, oh, it doesn't mean anything. It's just a hallmark holiday. You know what? But it comes to mean something, doesn't it? It certainly comes to mean something. It's a way to celebrate your mother and say thank you. Say thank you to your mother for giving birth to you. It's that simple. No matter how mean she may have been to you, she gave birth to you. So, you know, I once went through this with a rabbi's wife because I was conflicted by the statement in the Big Ten Commandments, which says that honor thy mother and thy father. I don't honor thy mother and thy father. So I said, how can you honor a mother or father who's been abusive to you? How does that work? So this woman researched this, and from a biblical perspective, what she said was, it doesn't mean honor them as though they're on a pedestal. It means honor the fact that they gave you life. And that way you can have it both ways. You can remember that they gave you life and still say they were bad to you. And then that's the end of it. You can have nothing to do with them. If that's the way it is, if they're always putting you down and are always trying to get something from you, which occurs, unfortunately, all too often in most families, by the way. You know, the life with father image of family has never been real. It's all a fiction. You're very lucky if you have it, but most people don't. Family is a very difficult act. It's a very hard thing to pull off and to do it right. And for those of you who don't know how to raise a children, I'm going to give it a child. I'm going to give you an answer. I'm an older guy. Many of you are young guys who've just had children or are going to have children. You may not have an older man in your family. You may not know what to do. I'm going to make it simple for you since it's wrapped up in this whole show today. I remember when my first child was born, I didn't know how to raise a child. What did I know? I was a child myself at the time. I was a young guy. I was immature. I was what I was. I didn't know what to do. So I spoke to my uncle, who was a World War II veteran, a pretty nice guy, although I had my problems with him, too. I seem to have problems with everybody. I don't know, just the way I am. And he just looked at me. He had no children of his own. His wife could not bear. But he loved me. He loved his nephews and nieces. And he said, well, he said, all you got to remember is one thing. Just love your child. That's it. That's the whole message. That's the entire message of child rearing. Now, love your child doesn't mean bend over backwards like a liberal and let him smear mud on the wall. It doesn't mean that. It doesn't mean let him crawl all over you or ruin your life. Love requires discipline. You'll find out soon enough. Love requires knowing when to say no to your child. That's the hardest thing to learn. Love requires a lot of strength. So that's what is the whole picture. 855-407-2822. I didn't know where I was going to go with today's show. There's so many areas that I touched on. Banned in Britain. The election in the UK, which will have no effect on me whatsoever, nor will I think it'll change anything. Because the sick truth is that Obama's campaign advisor, Jim Messina, is the one who brought this so-called conservative leader to victory. I mean, what does that tell you? If Obama sends his campaign advisor to England to re-elect Cameron, and then he sends his brain, whatever his name is, Axelrod, to run the Labour campaign, it means Obama was manipulating the British election. Do you understand that just like he tried to manipulate the election in Israel, he's now manipulating the election in England? Only what you don't even understand is while we're told the Tories won, it's Obama who won. Just take that, think about it over the weekend. While you're laughing along with Cameron, thinking he's going to save the West. Certainly better than the Labourite winning, that's for sure. 855-407-2822. Many, many stories, many topics. I know many of you want to talk about the emotional part of the show. I get it. WJR in Detroit. Jason, go ahead, please. Thanks for holding. You're on the Savage Nation. What's on your mind?
Hey, thanks, Michael, and thanks for this topic. I have a heavy heart. I'm trembling from hearing your brother's story. My son, he is 7. He was born May 14th. Him and his brother were identical, both born dead. Neglect was involved, but regardless, after 13 minutes, my son Hawk, he came back to life, and long story short, he's turned 7 this year. 10 brain surgeries, cerebral palsy, but he's got a spirit that lights up the room, smile on his face, and I do a lot in advocacy, and I work for a nonprofit on the side. And I just would like to encourage any parent listening, and it's not always going to happen, but I've heard so many stories where doctors give these terrible predictions, and I tell you, the pendulum swings in favor of that child and the parent, because so many of these stories, the doctors are dead wrong, and these kids overcome so many obstacles.
Well, because the doctor looks at the sick child from a mechanistic point of view, not from the spiritual or soul point of view. And if the parent speaks to the soul or the spirit, that will often heal the body to a certain extent. We're not talking about miracle healings. So, Jason, I really appreciate that. Are you married? I hope you are.
Yeah, I'm married for 17 years. We've got
okay, I got a special prize for you. I'm going to give you a free order of Shari's Berries for Mother's Day to show your wife how much you care with Shari's Berries. And they're one of my key advertisers, as well as many others. But it's Mother's Day, so you're getting a free bunch of those delicious chocolate coated as strawberries, which I happen to love. I'm really into chocolate now. Love it. What do you want to talk about now? World War II, VE Day, then the war in the Pacific followed it, incidentally. You know, I mean, we know that Europe was pacified on June 8th, but the war in the Pacific was still raging onward. And my father-in-law, may he rest in peace, wonderful man. He died of cancer about, I don't even remember, 10, 15 years ago. I don't want to mention his name, but the thing is, this is a farm boy from Indiana who went to Harvard, played on the Harvard football team, went to Harvard Law School from a farm, went into the United States Navy in World War II at the height of the war, was a gunnery officer. And frankly, had Truman, after the war in Europe, where he was almost killed several times from enemy guns that almost blew him out of the water, had Truman not dropped two bombs on Japan and forced them to surrender, the estimates were 1 million American men would have died taking the islands of Japan because, and I did this show many years ago, this exact show, I'll never forget it as long as I live, and a Japanese man called me and he said that you're 100% right, Michael. He said, my grandmother told me that as a little girl, she was told by the leaders in Japan to sharpen a bamboo stick and to kill any American who came to take away, you know, their honor. They were going to fight to the last man, woman, and child in Japan. The American leaders knew that, unlike the creatures that we have in the White House now, who the most they know is how to go to a girly show, if they're even lucky. That's if they're even oriented that way. The sorority knows nothing about ISIS, which is why we're losing the war. And I think I'll pause on that terrible note. I'll be right back.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-400-7282. Savage.
Hey, our Savage Nation is sponsored by SwissAmerica.com, the only company I trust for wealth insurance, gold and silver. Call 800-BUY-COIN.
Welcome back to the program. You know, it's a program like this, like today's show, where I go into a different state of mind and a different state of thinking and presenting myself. That's very important because it's so easy to stereotype an individual in the media. You don't know me. You don't know my totality. How can you? And so those of you who like my message will take anything I say and say he's a great guy, not knowing the negatives that I have. And those of you who hate my message will try to turn me into what I'm not. But it's true for all human beings. We're a whole universe unto ourselves. And until you know the whole man, you really shouldn't speak about him. It's as simple as that. So let's go to the callers on the program today. This is great. I mean, this is like a weird kind of show, honestly. I admit maybe many of you are bummed out by it. I don't know. I mean, I could do just straight out politics, and that I do on a regular basis. We have such good stuff. The guys prepared a montage of the week's best sound, which I will play probably at 34 minutes after the hour because it'll trigger all of the stuff we did this week of the week in review. We'll talk more about politics of the day here and how 94 million people are not in the workforce in America. So they're not counted in the unemployment figures because the con man in the White House, of course, has rigged the figures so that you would think we have a low unemployment rate, which is true, unless you include all the people who are not in the labor force. Then the unemployment rate would be 15% or maybe 20%. Same as your money. You think the dollar is worth a dollar? He makes money, prints it. The con man prints the money to keep buying votes. It's the good old Chicago way. In the old days in Chicago, they gave out bottles of cherry brandy, I understand, to the poor in the streets to get them to vote for the machine. Here he gives out a welfare check or a food stamp or a this or that, you know, one thing after the other. And the irony here is that we voted in November to throw out this laborite. You want to put him in the labor context of the British? We voted to get rid of socialism. And instead of him resigning with some dignity like they did in England, he doubles down and gives us the middle finger and says, drop dead. And he becomes even more fanatically communistic, socialistic, arrogant. Okay? That's why I can't even do politics anymore. We don't have a democracy. England has a far greater democracy than we have. We have a sham. We have a monopoly system run by two gangs. What do you want to talk about? I don't know if I want to do anything about that. I don't think I want to do special needs children or World War II right now. I don't know what I want to do. I'm not sure. I don't know exactly what. Let me look for a good soundbite that I want to do. I think I want to shift gears. My emotions are. I hear the teapot whistling in the radio kitchen, which means that thank God the break's coming in 37 seconds, or I'll set the radio studio on fire. So I think I better. You know that Nigel Farage resigned as the leader of the right-wing UKIP party? This is what they do when they lose. Obama should have resigned in November and said, I screwed up my party. The Democrats can't win. If it was run legitimately, what? What it represent? 10% of the population wants socialism with that hag, Hillary? That harridan? That criminal?
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-400-7282.
All right, it's your show. We can go where you want with it. It's Rock and Roll Friday. It's open mic to mic Friday, 855-407-282. Unfortunately, most people have called on the topics that I basically was talking about, you know, special needs children, World War II veterans, and many of you calling about your parents who fought. Some of you have parents who fought with Patton's Army. Some of you know some of the horrors of World War II. Here's Steve on WMAL in Washington. Steve, what's on your mind?
Yes, sir. I just wanted to say that today I had an opportunity to go over to Roosevelt Island and watch the World War II flyover commemorating VE Day with other members of the National Guard. And what struck me was not only the awe, might that the United States possessed in World War II, but the charity that we had to leave Europe to a large extent and allow them to have self-rule, and the fact that the World War II veterans that were with us were still emotional 70 years later, as I am even saying this, having served in Afghanistan, Iraq, and Kosovo.
Well, God bless you, but you know what? How many World War II veterans would ever believe that they fought so we could have a nation as the one we have today under this socialist, communist, anti-American administration? How good can they feel about their sacrifice for this nation? I mean, we are under the threat of a third world war that has been started already. You know, people think it's hyperbole. They're at war. It's a millennial war. They've been at war with the rest of the world for millennia. Now it's our turn. And now we're told they're in 50 states ready to strike. Our good friends, the practitioners of the religion of peace, and we're supposed to look the other way because we have cowardly leaders who are appeasing them.
Yes, sir. I would.
What sane nation on earth would bring in 100,000 Muslims without vetting them for terrorism ties, without asking if they practice a peaceful version of Islam, or if they practice a despicable, hateful jihad vision of Islam? Who would bring them into a nation?
Well, I will say this. Walking past the statue of Theodore Roosevelt on the island there, and some of the sayings that he has on there, manhood, the state, and some of the other stuff, I don't think people of his generation would have encountered the same problems, because they led from the front. They weren't afraid to...
Well, Obama's leading from the front and the front of the other army.
Well,
that's also, you got right about that. He's a very brave man. He's so good at it, we don't even know it. All right, look, I can be sarcastic all I want. It doesn't get us anywhere. I'm sending you a free copy of my book about the war that we're in. It's called Countdown to Mecca. It's coming out Monday. And if you respect the show and you respect me, I suspect you're going to go to the bookstore and check it out. Or buy it from Amazon or any of the other sites. Because I'm not doing any more of those novels. I'm telling you right now, not. Like, you should care. You shouldn't care. It doesn't matter to me. It doesn't matter whether I do them or not. You shouldn't care whether I do them or not either. All that matters is that we have the strength to talk about what's real. Now, you read Conservative Party defies polls. What polls? Polls are fake. What do you mean defies polls? They're run by liberals. In America, the polls are run by liberals. The media is run by liberals. The Republican Party is run by liberals. The campaign advisors are all liberal. So what do you mean run by liberals? They run the whole Western world, which is why we're weak. Why we're losing the war against ISIS. Now, who said we're losing the war against ISIS? Perhaps the bravest senator in the Congress, Senator Cotton. He said ISIS seems to be winning now. He's an Iraq and Afghanistan war veteran who happens to be in the Senate. The Republicans put him at the back of the bus. Instead of taking this young man who was just elected and putting him at the front of the party, those evildoers, Boehner and McConnell, put him at the back of the bus. And yet he knows what's going on. He said the Islamic State is actively trying to inspire attacks, as we know, by recruiting youths who view the terror group as a winning force. And we know about the slain gunmen who attacked the Muhammad cartoon drawing contest Sunday in Texas. We know they were inspired by the Islamic State. But if we had an active administration who was actively trying to stop the neo-Nazis of today, the Islamo-fascists of today, whatever you want to call them, it's as though Hitler's alive and well speaking Arabic. Only now he's protected by the amendment that protects freedom of religion. You get, well, that's really a great racket. That's really a hell of a racket they got going for them. Duck and hide, duck and cover behind the religion while planning to kill us. And the schmucks who run the government aren't allowed to do anything. They can do something about it. They can say, take it, my friend. A religion is a religion of peace or it's not a religion at all. And that's it. And if you're going to preach hatred, get the hell out of my country. That's what a country would do if it wanted to survive. Don't use your religion as a Trojan horse to conquer the country, because we are the country. We know who the hell you are, and you're not going to get away with it here. That's what would go on in a sane country. That's what would go on if we had a legitimate government of the people, by the people, and for the people. We are all screaming for such representation, are we not? Can you tell me anyone in this country who wants to placate the radical Muslims? You're telling me the liberals want to see homosexuals stoned and thrown off roofs? Are they that dumb? They're not that dumb. So there we are. You talk about what the election in England means to me. That's what the election in England means to me. That if we had freedom in this country, Obama would have resigned or his own party would have thrown him out come January. He lost in November. They would have said, I'm sorry, you wrecked the party. You wrecked the chances of the Democrats. You're leading us over the cliff. The people spoke. Please step aside, Mr. Obama, and let doofus Biden take over. Anybody but you. The people don't trust you. The people don't like you. The people actually hate you. And so, therefore, for the sake of the party and for the sake of America, we're asking you to step down. That would have been a legitimate thing to do. But no, not Obama. He's too proud. He's too proud to care what the people think. After all, he is the people. What he thinks is what the people think. What he does is what the people want to do. There are no people. We're nothing. We're sheeple to him to be manipulated by flooding America with so many millions of illegal aliens that by 2016 you won't have a vote or a voice. So don't tell me I don't see what's going on. Doesn't mean I have to talk about it every second. I do. How this game plays out, I don't know with ISIS. They're telling Westerners in Western Europe or North America, stay home, don't come to Syria, attack inside your homeland. That's what Senator Cotton is saying. And believe it or not, he says that the Patriot Act, which is very controversial, should be renewed. And he knows more than I do. I feel very uncomfortable with that statement. Because Senator Cotton is my hero. I would vote for him for the presidency if I could. There's no chance he's ever going to get there, not in my lifetime, not with the capitulators running the party. But he says that ISIS working in this country to inspire attacks in the U.S. provides justification for renewing provisions in the controversial Patriot Act. He said that's one reason why it's so important that we reauthorize the expiring provisions of the Patriot Act, which would help stop these exact kind of attacks. There's a two-edged sword there, because that would be true if we had a legitimate representative government. But you and I both know what will happen when you have David Axelrod running the country. You and I both know what will happen when we have such louts on the left running the country. They will not use the renewed Patriot Act to go after Muslims who may be plotting to recruit an attack. They will use those renewed powers to attack the patriots in this country. That's the sad truth. I'm Michael Savage, and I believe in my monologue. I think what we need to do is clean off the board right now. I don't want to do any more of what I was doing. It's up on the board. I can't take any of those calls. I don't know if I want to go there. I think what I'm going to do now is this. The guys put together a fabulous montage of all of the key sound bites of the week from Monday through Thursday, and they'll bring up all the topics of the week, which are so interesting and important. Let's just play them, Robert. Let's hear them.
But what people are saying is that there's always this fine line, you know, between freedom of speech and being intentionally incendiary and provocative.
Intentionally incendiary and provocative by drawing a cartoon. This is the low state of freedom of speech in this country.
Can you brag a bit more about your officer here? I mean, I think the scenario is two guys with assault rifles who may be wearing protective gear up against one officer with a service pistol.
He did what he was trained to do, and under the fire that he was put under, he did a very good job and probably saved lives.
In every community in America, there are young people with incredible drive and talent, and they just don't have the same kinds of chances that somebody like me had. They're just as talented as me, just as smart. They don't get a chance.
Now, the group that did the insulting says it's entitled to profane Mohammed because in the Islamic religion, any kind of depiction of him is a sin. They say they can do that in America because of freedom of speech. They have the right to do it here. But again, it's stupid.
She didn't use the tools available to her. She herself is terribly inexperienced. She never personally was involved in any cases of these magnitude. And further of all, you can look at the charges themselves that tell you that she doesn't have her ducks in a row.
There are so many kids in this country who look at places like museums and concert halls and other cultural centers, and they think to themselves, well, that's not a place for me, for someone who looks like me, for someone who comes from my neighborhood. In fact, I guarantee you that right now there are kids living less than a mile from here who would never in a million years dream that they would be welcome in this museum. And growing up on the south side of Chicago, I was one of those kids myself.
That's all, folks. I'll be right back on the Savage Nation.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-400-7282. Savage.
My Savage Nation is sponsored by SwissAmerica.com. It's the only company I trust to protect my wealth. Call 800-BUY-CO-IN.
So the sneakiest president in American history who's working for forces we can only imagine is now trying to get fast-track authority on a secret trade deal. He will not disclose what's in the trade deal. No one has read the trade deal, and those who read it down in the basement of Congress have their notes taken from them by the sorority gang so they can't share them with the press or the people. This is a dictatorship as sure as I'm sitting here. Obama's the most dictatorial president in American history. He was never fit for office. He was voted out of office in November. And now this lout has the nerve to demand fast-track authority for a new trade deal with Asia. And guess who's on board with him? McConnell and Boehner and the Republican establishment. And so we don't even know what's in the bill. Well, there's an article on Infowars.com which says, secret deal could contain a myriad of gun restrictions and ammo bans. Will UN-style gun control be rammed down our throats? This is what this sneaky socialist is doing. Exactly what you feared. Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell and Senator Orrin Hatch, another one, may soon give Obama authority to write gun control restrictions into a so-called trade agreement. Did you hear this? Fast track bill S-995. What's in it? No one knows. Will there be gun import bans? Will there be micro-stamping of firearms, ammunition bans, the full implementation of the anti-gun UN arms trade treaty? Illegal amnesty, which locks in millions of new anti-gun voters from Mexico and China. These items, including the anti-gun items, could be part of the secret trade agreement that Obama is getting ready to launch onto the Congress. Trade pact is called Fast Track. And what that means is that the president can write any form of gun control he chooses into a trade agreement. Import bans, amnesty, anything he wants. It can go well beyond trading with Asia. And by the way, this agreement doesn't give the dictator the need to go to two-thirds vote in the Senate. No, the sneaky demagogue in the White House. When completed, this agreement would only be subject to a majority vote in both houses. It cannot be filibustered. It cannot be amended. And the grand old party can't refuse to consider it. So what's in the bill? Reports are surfacing that the top secret draft giving Obama this dictatorial power over America contains an entire chapter with a European Union-style provision allowing unlimited migration from Mexico into the United States, just what we need. This would give Obama's dream machine just what they want. Just what they want, to bring in millions of non-English-speaking, anti-gun, socialist voters into the nation. So if you want to read the details of the Trans-Pacific Partnership trade deal from the most, let us say, transparent president in communist Chinese history, you've got to be a member of Congress, and you've got to go to a classified briefing in the basement, and you've got to leave your staff and cell phone at the door. If you're a member of the Congress and you want to read the text, you've got to go to the sneaks, a room in the basement of the Capitol Visitor Center, and be handed it one section at a time being looked at as you read it, and then hand over any notes you make before leaving. This is what this demonic devil in the White House has done to this country. By the way, your congressman cannot discuss the detail of what they've read. Is that the country that you thought you'd be living in under this con man? This guy is out to get you any way he can. And it doesn't matter whether you're white, black, yellow. It doesn't matter if you're gay or straight. The man is a maniac. But the conservative Republicans don't believe what I'm saying. Why? Because all they care about is the free trade side. All they care about is making Microsoft happy. All they care about is making General Electric happy. All they care about is, well, you get the picture. If it's got a dollar sign on it, the Republicans are for it. They could care less about the rest of the bill. Because the Obama administration is known to be the sneakiest administration in history. We know about smuggling guns to Mexico, the IRS scandal. We know about him ignoring one law after another, bypassing Congress on matters such as immigration, the Bergdahl prisoner swap, the alleged economic benefits of TPP. All of them bypass the laws of the land. That is because Obama, by nature, is a lawless individual who thinks he is above everyone and above the law. The bottom line is you cannot let your representatives support the trade bill with Asia. And what's interesting here is that some liberals oppose it and some unions oppose it. And those supporting it are the so-called Republicans like Boehner and McConnell. Go figure that one out. That's what happens when you're blinded by greed. That's what happens when you're nothing but an errand boy for Microsoft or General Electric. Well, that's it for the first 2 hours of the Savage Nation. Victory Day, UK election, brother's birthday, giveaway berries, whatever. Another big hour across America. Be here or be nowhere. I'm Michael Savage.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-400-7282. Warning, the Savage Nation contains adult language, adult content, psychological nudity. Listener discretion is advised. And now, America's most exciting radio talk show, The Savage Nation, home of unprotected talk, borders, language, culture. And here he is, Michael Savage.
Welcome back, Tower number 3, or if you're just joining the program, welcome. First 2 hours were quite emotional and then moved into something quite different. Emotional in a different key or in a different sense. I dedicated the show today to, well, it's May 8th, VE Day. It's the day that the Germans surrendered and signed a formal surrender agreement and the end of their horrendous war where Superman was defeated by every man, just as ISIS one day will be defeated by every man if we get a leader who is capable of leading the every man against the vermin who are here in every state. How could you have them in every state without rounding them up or yanking them out by their hair? I don't understand it. The FBI says they're in every state instead of going and busting down the doors and pulling them out by their rotten beards and saying, screw you, you're not going to kill anyone here. What do you mean they're in 50 states? What's the point of having an FBI if they can't do anything? That is, you see why I get my blood boils. What a nation of idiots. Oh, the FBI, yo, we know we're following him for 8 years. Then they let him blow up the Boston Marathon. They're following him for 9 years. They let him shoot up a free speech event in Texas, which O'Reilly now supports on the other side. Not exactly, you know what I mean, but he attacks Pamela Geller. By attacking Pamela Geller, basically supporting ISIS. He tried to have it both ways, the leprechaun. So, yeah, you look back at World War II, great. What'd you learn from it? That if you had a president like Obama, you'd be speaking German. The rest of you would be a lampshade. That's what you learned from World War II. They would have had our signature on a piece of paper if we had Obama as a leader. That's what you'd have today. Write that one down. Make a note of it. If Obama had been the commander-in-chief at that time, we would have been signing the surrender sheet, not the Germans. That's topic number 2. Topic 3 is the election in England. Oh, conservative Tories won. Yeah, won by a landslide. And who was their campaign advisor? Who? Jim Messina, who is Obama's campaign manager. What does that tell you, you fools? You don't understand how the cards are being shuffled. You're ready for Las Vegas. Go to Las Vegas with your paycheck. So if you look back at World War II, it's a clear victory against evil, pure evil, defeated by pure good. That's what World War II was. And I'll remind those of you who are ignorant and don't know history that after the defeat of Germany and their surrender, there was still a raging war in the Pacific because the Japanese, with their spirit of Bushido, were not willing to give up. The military would not surrender. Their air force had been wiped out. Their navy had been destroyed. But they were ready to fight for every square block, every square piece of land in Japan. They were going to fight with every man, woman, and child. And the estimates by the U.S. military, who cared about the troops then, was that it would have cost between, I think the number was 500,000 to a million troops would have died, our troops, taking the islands of Japan in a hand-to-hand battle. And we had had the development of the atomic weapons ongoing. We beat Japan to the development of an atomic bomb, and we beat Germany to the development of an atomic bomb, owing to the genius of America. And as a result, we bombed them first. And as a result, finally, Japan surrendered. And as a result, a million Americans didn't die. And I want to remind you again that many of you are children of men who had fought in Europe, who were then going to be asked to go to Japan. After living through the horrors of the European battles, they were going to then have to put them on ships across the Pacific and go fight the Japanese. You wouldn't be here had we not had Truman, Truman. And by the way, the Japanese were terrified when they heard that Truman became president after FDR died. They're very into symbolism. They said, oh, Truman, the word Truman symbolized to them what was coming. And here come the truth. Well, he gave them the truth. Two atomic bombs. Now, no one's celebrating the death of innocent civilians. We know all about that, but it's better them than us at the time. That's the way he figured it out. And in my family, it's very close. I mean, it's a very personal thing. My father-in-law was a wonderful man, Indiana farm boy, as I mentioned. Went from the farm, I don't know what college, I think he went to Harvard, then Harvard Law, went in the Navy, gunnery officer, missed dying many times from enemy shells, men blown up in front of his eyes. He was getting ready to go to Japan. They were getting ready to ship him to Japan. Had he gone, he probably would have died. And my family wouldn't be here today. But he died himself a couple of years ago. Terrible cancer. Charles Robert Rowe, we salute you on the Savage Nation. We also devoted the show to my deceased brother, my silent brother. And I read about that from my book, Train Tracks. Jerome, born May 8th, 1944, died October 12th, 1969. That was quite moving. And, you know, we had people calling with children in their family who are severely, I don't know the word they use today, special needs. You know, I'm from another generation. We said handicapped. We didn't mean we're putting anyone down. That's all. We said it was handicapped. I mean, well, we weren't negating anybody. That's what happened to them. That's how they were. So I dedicated the show to them, and we got, so I thought, some very touching calls in the first hour. And then we talked again, and we went round the back to the British elections, which are very personal to me, because I'm the only member of the American media, no matter how many poseurs you may listen to, none of them are banned from entering Britain. I'm proud to tell you I'm banned from entering Britain. And banned, by the way, by an evil Labourite government that I was told once they were out of office, my name would be taken off the list. Well, Cameron came along and he didn't do it. Now Cameron won again, and I know he still won't take my name off the list. And I've been trying to free my name from this list ever since 2009. It's man against government. You usually don't win, by the way. One man against the government doesn't win. Emily Dickinson said, 'tis the majority in this, as all prevail, assent, and you are sane. Demure, you're straightaway dangerous. And handled with a chain. Emily Dickinson, I'll read it again if you want to know what freedom of speech is. Actually, I opened this book, Banned in Britain, very small publication. I did it to document the letters we found, the emails from Gordon Brown in England through the Freedom of Information Act. It cost me $400,000 from evil lawyers in England and I never got off the list. They just took my money and ran. Typical, you know. But as a result of that campaign that I ran against the government, we discovered why I was banned from Britain. And it wasn't just about me and other Americans concerned about a cultural shift towards totalitarianism and their rights to freedom of expression that I have been waging this battle ever since 2009. There are other reasons. I want people to know what a government's really like, how evil they are, no matter how nice the suit is, no matter how well tied the tie is, no matter how well shaven the man, no matter how nicely they speak. Some of them are absolute villains. And we found the emails. And here is, I actually have the emails. You'll never believe it. Gordon Brown, the prime minister at the time, actually wrote an email in England to one of his stooges, one of his puppets, and said, I'm going to paraphrase now, that we have to banish Michael Savage to balance the list. Do you know what that means? Because they had banned vicious Muslims who called for the overthrow of England, they wanted to make it look as though they were balanced, so they banned an American conservative. Would you believe this? Well, you better believe it. I have the emails to prove it. And I want to remind you that when that happened, the very same thing that's happening to Pamela Geller happened to me. Nobody came to my aid. The very same forces on Fox News that are attacking Geller basically ignored me or attacked me. The very same silence you hear from Rush Limbaugh and the cartel is what I got. So in the age of cheap talk show hosts with widely accessible audiences, you pay for what you get. Let's put it to you that way. And that's it. That's the story. I mean, up until 2009, I wrote this. I wrote that I've been leading a fairly charmed life. It said, I've led somewhat of a life of charm until now with a few bumps. I finally hit a stone wall, the old cracked but never breaking stone walls of monarchic England. Our original oppressive ruler, now quasi-Marxist do-gooders, fearing for their lives, pick on the innocent to protect the liberty of the guilty. Overrun by the insanity of their own policies of ultra-tolerance, they choose intolerance as a quick defense. The once proud British of Churchill, the victors of the Battle of Britain, where so many flowers of Cambridge and Oxford nobly sacrificed their lives, now reduced to broken flower pots of people ruling Britannia. Overrun by people who hate them, hate their race, hate their whiteness, the broken shards of England choose to condemn an American patriot, a man who speaks of borders, of language, of culture. He is the enemy of the shards of England's pride. He is now the sum total of all that threatens the island's survival. This free spirit ensnared by the descendants of those bold Norsemen now fallen, their clay feet crumbling. Although the news story in blaring headlines was that Michael Savage, talk show host, was banned in Britain, the subtext was really this. Quote, Michael Savage, nationalist and patriot, banned from the globalist system. The rationalization provided for the ban was nothing more than a collection of sound bites taken out of context. They were used to put me in league with murderers and terrorists in order to castigate me and make me appear to be a genuinely bad guy. The fact of the matter is that this is a subterfuge by globalist power players to make sure that any true nationalist, even a nonviolent nationalist, is criminalized. That's how I began this self-published book, Banned in Britain, which I'm not selling to you, by the way, which I published in 2009 as Savage Productions book in order to set the record straight. And those missing emails from Gordon Brown and the others in that vile labor government can be found in there. Maybe you can learn something from it. So there it is. That's the show we've been covering so far. If you'd like to talk about these topics or any other related topics, trade agreements, you name it, the phone number is 855-407-2282. This is Hour 3. I'll be right back.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-400-7282. Savage.
My Savage Nation is sponsored by SwissAmerica.com, the only company I trust to protect my wealth with gold and silver. Call 800-BUYCOIN.
It is the Savage Nation. As you know, I am a student of history, and I know many of you have a beef with Aryans, but did you know that there was Aryan beef? One of the magazines I just bought today was called World War II and about Germany being crushed. So I was flipping through the magazine before the show today, and I found this little column, Aryan Beef Found Too Bullish to Bother With. Besides a race of Aryan supermen, Nazis wanted super cows too, I read. In the 1920s, German zoologist Heinz and Lutz Heck sought to resurrect the auroch, a wild species the Teutons mentioned in their legends. Crossbreeding domestic cattle, the brothers Heck arrived at what modern farmer then called a reasonable facsimile of the ancient genetic line. Nazi leaders prized the shaggy longhorn beasts as meaty examples of German might and scientific acumen. The strain of modernist pseudo-aurochs survived the Third Reich, and in 2009, British farmer Derek Gow imported a few to raise on his Devon farm. Not commercially, but to study and photograph. Well, the beasts proved hard to manage. Many of the big ruminants would just attack you any chance they got, the farmer said. They would try to kill anyone who came near them. Well, after tolerating several years of bad behavior by the ill-tempered behemoths, a specimen can weigh in at 1,900 pounds. Farmer Gow slaughtered seven of the 13 animals. One byproduct, the cattleman noted, was an inventory of very tasty sausage. And that, Robert, is the story of Aryan Beef. Just to show you that there's many different ways to skin the cat, talking about World War II. There are so many facets that you can't even imagine them, because that's what history is all about, is finding the facets that you don't know. And one day, if we survive this regime, people will look back and say, how did the people not rise up? The man was naked about his intentions to ensnare them and enslave them. The man was nakedly permitting the enemy to run rampant in the country. And how did so many millions of American men permit him to get away with it, they will ask? How did they not ask the FBI that if they know that there are Islamists in 50 states threatening to kill and maim and blow things up, they don't arrest them preemptively and take them off the street? They'll ask, how is that possible? They will ask, how could a ragtag army without an air force, without a navy, be gaining so much territory against the most powerful military on earth? That's what people will ask if we survive the devil in the White House. Because there's no one else to blame. It's him. It's all coming from him. All of it's coming from him. All of it's coming from him. A fish rots from the head down. In England, when the parties lost, the leaders of those parties just resigned immediately. Did you hear the resignation speeches? The Millichamp we played. Labour Party's Ed Miliband, rather, resigned immediately upon losing. The head of the UKIP party resigned. Farage resigned immediately for losing. In America, the loser, Obama, who wrecked his own legacy, is that of deceiving the American people. And the American people went to the polls in record numbers and said, we say no to this. They said no to the labor view, the communist view, the socialist view, whatever you want to call it. We voted against him and his party, and we voted against his policies. And what happened the next day? He mocked us. Do you remember this humble man looked at us and sneered at us? And he doubled down and he said, screw you, basically, I'll do what I want. And look what he's done since then. And history will say, how did they let him do it? How did they let a so-called opposition party not stop him? How did the people not rise up and demand that their voices be heard? That's what history will ask if we should have a history. And that's what I'm giving you today, this May 8th, as a gift to you from my brother Jerome. A view of the future today, right here on the Savage Nation. So don't just look at World War II and feel victorious. Look at the war your country is in right now and ask yourself where we are and why we are here.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-400-7282.
Thank God he lost, but, you know, don't count your blessings so fast. It's all a sham. There's very little difference between the Labour Party in England and the Tory Party in England, and I'll prove it in one sentence. Take a guess who advised Cameron on how he could win the election. Obama's campaign manager, Messina, Jim Messina. What does that tell you? If Obama's political advisor, Jim Messina, is getting credit for leading conservative British Prime Minister David Cameron to a victory, what does it tell you about David Cameron? It tells you it's all rigged. It tells you there's no difference in the West between one side and the other with regard to most issues. Certainly there are fine details that separate the two. But if Axelrod is representing the Labor Party in advising them, and he loses, and Jim Messina, who he calls his brother, advised the other guy, it tells you the same scam that's going on in America is going on in England. Moreover, what the hell are these guys doing in England to begin with? What do they need these creeps to go over there for and mess up the English elections? There's only one good note coming out of England. I want you to hear it in clip two. This is the Labour Party, the Ed Miliband, who was defeated. Listen to what he said in clip two.
This has clearly been a very disappointing and difficult night for the Labour Party.
Thank God.
We haven't made the gains we wanted in England and Wales. And in Scotland, we've seen a surge of nationalism overwhelm our party.
Did you hear the word nationalism? Who in America who has been calling for a nationalist party, Michael Savage, who has told you that a nationalist party could win after a certain number of years in America, Michael Savage? Who has defined his radio career by the three words, borders, language, and culture, Michael Savage? But here's the good news. In England, when a party leader is defeated, he resigns out of shame. I want you to listen to three, and you'll hear what a real democracy sounds like in clip three.
Britain needs a strong Labour Party. Britain needs a Labour Party that can rebuild after this defeat so we can have a government that stands up for working people again. And now it's time for someone else to take forward the leadership of this party. So I'm tendering my resignation, taking effect after this afternoon's commemoration of VE Day at the Cenotaph. I want to do so straight away, because the party needs to have an open and honest debate about the right way forward without constraint.
So he resigned. He resigned because he lost. Now, in America, we had an election in November. It was a landslide against Obama's communist, socialist, Islamist policies. And instead of resigning, as he should have, you know what he did? He told us to drop dead. He doubled down, then he tripled down on his left-wing fanaticism. So don't fool yourself for 1 minute. The left wing in this country is a broken wing. America has rejected that broken wing. America has said no to that broken wing over and over again. But this small band of fanatics who have destroyed the Democrat Party, the same small band of fanatics who dominate the American media, want you to believe that they are the majority. They are not the majority. They're a tiny minority. No one in the media has more at stake in what happened in the UK in the media than me. Because remember, I'm the only member of the media, I'm proud to tell you, still banned from entering England. And I told you the story. The definitive fight for free speech is me. And how one man stood firm against an entire government to free my name from a list of murderers and terrorists. And I've never freed my name because of Gordon Brown and the scum in the Labour Party. So thank God at least the Labour Party didn't win. But Cameron, who had promised people who knew me he'd take my name off the list, shamed himself by not doing so. You know what I'm saying? It's a huge scandal in England. And what's going on in America is very, very near and dear to my heart because of what went on in England. And I know an awful lot about free speech. And I want to make a side note. No one in the American media save one person came to my defense. I think it was only Laura Ingraham on radio who came to my aid. Not the big mouth Rush Limbaugh, the great conservative. He made believe it didn't happen. Because if it's not about him and if he can't capitalize on it in some way or make it part of his show, it's of no interest to him. He didn't help me. Certainly Hannity didn't say a word. O'Reilly didn't say a word. No one on Fox News came to my aid. But the preface of the book says the savage fight against censorship. Isn't that interesting? Isn't that funny? Savage was fighting against censorship in England. And it's an important story. We can talk about that as well. Banned in Britain, Michael Savage beating the liberal blacklist. Well, I never beat it. I'm still on it. We can talk about Barack Obama's political advisor, Jim Messina, getting credit for leading conservative British Prime Minister David Cameron to an overwhelming victory. You get that one? There are many other topics. Do you feel the gang problem in America is better or worse under Obama? Do you feel any speech should have severe limits? Do you think Pamela Geller should get FBI protection or Secret Service? Of course she should, but they threw her to the wolves. The NYPD said that she's on a hit list, and the FBI says, you know what, screw her. She got what she deserved. And there's something else you have to know. The FBI said they overlooked the Texas Muslim shooter's violent tweets because there are so many like them. Did you hear this? The official said there are so many like him that you have to prioritize your investigations. Really? That's very interesting, because the Islamic State just said that they have at least 71 active Islamic State members in the U.S. trained to kill. Why aren't they rounding them up? They may be on the FBI watch list. I mean, mixed in with watching Christians, returning war veterans, anti-abortion activists. Occasionally, they can devote 1% of the FBI's investigative abilities to looking into radicalized Muslims, couldn't they? Why are they bothering with patriotic Americans? Because Hussein is in the White House. In plain English, it's an upside-down world because of what's going on in the White House. So, Muhammad Art exhibit and contest. Provocative, yes. Offensive, yes. But we live in America. We don't live in Yemen. And provocation and offense is part of the culture of America, is it not? Look what Harvey Weinstein produces. Look what Sean Penn does in his movies. They're offensive movies to most of us. We don't burn theaters down because of what Weinstein produces. Do we burn theaters down because Weinstein attacks Christians in movies, making a mockery of people with crosses and turning everyone who goes to church into some kind of moron? We don't burn theaters down. We just don't go to the movie. Now, depictions of the Prophet Muhammad are another story to the liberal. Because they are, oh, they know the law, that they know. Oh, that's considered offensive in Islam, that's provocative. So what about Christians? Well, they don't kill, so we can provoke them. That's all, that's the whole story. So there's the story in a nutshell, and the hero here is the cop, the traffic cop, shot him dead in the head. Dead in the head. It wasn't the FBI who saved the attendees, it wasn't the ATF, it wasn't the Homeland Security. They did nothing. Nothing. They were there to taking pictures of everyone who attended, to see if they get him on a watch list. Texas traffic cop. All I can tell you is if you're driving through Texas, you better obey the traffic cops if they pull you over and ask you for your license. One thing you'll know now is that the Mujahideen are not going to use Texas as a testing ground for a probe. They're not going to try it again. They might, you know, they might actually go get the sturgeon this time instead of the virgin. They may find themselves swimming with the fishes. Anyway, that's the story. It's actually, it's an interesting story, and it's very good. It's actually good to this story. This is actually the first time, I think, that I've seen these brave Muslims with body armor this time and AKs come out shooting and get killed. Can you imagine if Clinton had not disarmed our troops at Fort Hood? Could you imagine if the troops all had weapons when the Muslim major Nidal Hassan went on a shooting spree and reloaded and shot 13, killed 13, injured something like 50-some-odd people. Imagine if Clinton had not disarmed our troops on bases, and they had had weapons, they could have killed the Muslim major, who was still alive, by the way. Timothy McVeigh was executed within 2 years, I think, or 2.5, less than that. The Muslim major is being protected by the powers that be. Why? Why haven't they executed Muslim Major Nidal Hassan? Why hasn't he been executed yet? Well, you tell me. But anyway, that's a sideshow. More to the point, I keep saying I have never. They keep topping themselves with their lies and the lowness of their existences. She doesn't feel like she belongs in museums. Kids who are poor or black don't belong in museums. And she said that growing up on the south side of Chicago, I was one of those kids myself, which is a complete lie, by the way. Total lie, as you know. But it leads you to ask a question. How come she didn't feel uncomfortable going to an Ivy League school? She went there. I mean, she must have been very uncomfortable. She got a degree there. And while we're asking the question about being uncomfortable, is she not uncomfortable about flying in Air Force One? I mean, after all, that's more intimidating. See, the implication is that a museum is a white man's place. And there's no place for a black woman in a white museum, even though it's the Whitney Museum. I don't know, maybe the end could have fallen off the head of the museum. Maybe the end fell off that day from a windstorm. and it said Whitey Museum, and she became uncomfortable. I don't know the answer. But she was at the Whitney Museum, and she says places like this, uncomfortable. She's giving a speech there at the Whitney Museum. Growing up, she felt uncomfortable. So how come she's not uncomfortable in Air Force One? How come she wasn't uncomfortable at the Ivy League colleges? Is she not uncomfortable about being the first lady to have her mother live in the White House at taxpayer expense? Is she not uncomfortable about the millions of people who are shocked and appalled at her abuse of taxpayer funds for her junkets around the world? That's what she should be uncomfortable about. It's a nonsense story, but I'm talking about it because the woman is saying this for a reason. She takes a podium like that, and what is she using that for? Use your head. What is she doing that for? What did her husband go to a Cinco de Mayo thing and talk about we are revolutionaries and we're not talking about the past, the future? What is he trying to do? If you were in a seminar and a teacher asked you that question, you can answer that easily. Make believe you're in a college seminar, a real college seminar, and yet a professor was trying to teach you about a communist revolutionary couple that took over a nation like this. And every day, in every way, in every speech, they try to foster dissent and discord, rather, in the people and foment revolution. So they're not happy enough with what they just did in Baltimore. Now what? What are they on to next? What city's next for them? What's on the horizon? I'll be right back.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-400-7282. Savage.
The Savage Nation is sponsored by SwissAmerica.com, the only company I, Michael Savage, trust to buy my gold and silver from. SwissAmerica.com. All right, the racial hatred of Obama and Michelle has gotten so bad that a Boston University professor, a black woman, has flunked white masculinity in a series of tweets. The hatred that's coming out of the mouths of these affirmative action hires is now reaching a crescendo. You judge for yourself and see if I'm wrong or is she wrong. Critics say a newly hired Boston University professor has crossed the line with recent tweets bashing whites. But the school says it's simply free speech. She wrote this, "White masculinity isn't a problem for America's colleges," she wrote. "White masculinity is the problem for America's colleges," said Saida Grundy, an incoming assistant professor of sociology and African American studies at BU. Now, as you well know, sociology is a nun science. It's sort of the dumping ground for liberal arts majors. And all of these ethnic studies departments are really in the same category. They're certainly not physical chemistry. In another tweet from January, she wrote, "Every MLK week, I commit myself to not spending a dime in white-owned businesses. And every year, I find it nearly impossible." In another tweet, this so-called professor called white males a problem population, very much like a Hitler-like thing. She asked, "Why is white America so reluctant to identify white college males as a problem population?" Now, could you imagine the Nazis doing this and writing this about Jews? But she's an assistant professor at Boston University. Can you believe this? The tweets of this vile individual were first noticed by a student, Nick Pappas, who posted them on his website and questioned how this person could be able to teach a diverse classroom given the racial hostility in her tweets. She said, "You have to teach college-age white males eventually, no? This seems like you're unqualified to grade their work as you clearly demonstrate some kind of special bias against them," he wrote. Of course he's right. Well, those who follow campus politics today say they're not shocked. David Horowitz said, "I'm not surprised that Boston University is hiring a racist to teach African-American studies. Anti-white racism is rampant in black studies programs, which are generally indoctrination programs in left-wing politics." But Boston University, which is really a nun university, stands by the professor who will start working at the college in June. BU spokesmouth Colin Riley said, "Professor Grundy is exercising a right to free speech, and we respect her right to do so." Hmm. Now, what if a white racist wrote this about black males? What if somebody in political science wrote tweets like this saying, quote, black masculinity isn't a problem for America's colleges. Black masculinity is the problem for America's colleges. And wait, while you're at it, all you good liberals, as you try to untwist your twisted mind, what if someone wrote every Washington's birthday holiday, I commit myself to not spending a dime in black-owned businesses, and every year I find it nearly impossible? Or what if a professor wrote every Washington's birthday, I commit myself to not watching a TV show in which there are blacks, and every year I find it nearly impossible? You'd find that sickening, wouldn't you? But not this way, right? This is allowed? This is what you want teaching your children? Is this what you want people... This is what your children to be exposed to. This is what they are being exposed to. And now you have the rest of the story. Boston University professor flunks white masculinity in controversial tweets. Says a lot for African studies, doesn't it? Yes, indeedy. Now, what else is in the news as we close the show today? Here's another wonderful one. The courts in Illinois, the Illinois Supreme Court, struck down a 2013 law that tried to limit pensions for union thugs. So in other words, the Supreme Court went along with the union thugs and said you have to pay the union thugs pensions you can't afford. And now you've heard the rest of the story. Monday, I want you in the bookstores. Monday, I want you to ask and demand for a copy up front of Countdown to Mecca.